Good afternoon and welcome to the State Department for this program to mark the International Day of Zero Tolerance for Female Genital Mutilation, or cutting, which it is also called. We want to welcome all of the ambassadors who are here with us, and I know there are officials from other ministries who are in Washington, and we're happy to have you join us as well. And we also have an audience that is joining up electronically from our embassies in Senegal, Mali, Burkina Faso, and Guinea, and hopefully they will have questions for our panel when we come to that part of the program. We are here to discuss a practice that is a serious violation of human rights, and it is one with harmful consequences for public health. It was almost 20 years ago that the then First Lady of the United States, in her historic speech at the 4th UN World Conference in Beijing, said, "If there is a message that echoes forth from this conference, it is that human rights are women's rights and women's rights are human rights." And among the litany of violations of human rights that she listed in her speech was the painful practice that we are discussing here today. And Secretary Clinton has continued to bring her considerable leadership and support of efforts focused on ending FGM. Where it exists, this practice is deeply entrenched. And we are very fortunate that today, in the panel that will follow, we will focus on some of the best models of community empowerment approaches to combating this practice. It is now my pleasure to invite Representative Crowley to say a few words. As a member of Congress, he has championed action here and abroad against this practice and authored bipartisan legislation along with Congresswoman Mary Bono Mack, who unfortunately could not be here today. And I know firsthand about his commitment to addressing this issue. And we are so pleased also to have Congressman Charlie Dent here, who is an original co-sponsor of this legislation. And as a member of the House Appropriations Committee, he's been a strong supporter of global health, including the struggle against HIV/AIDS. Combating FGM is truly a bipartisan issue. And we are so grateful that we could have both congressmen here today to help raise awareness about ways to end this practice. So without further ado, Congressman Crowley.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you very much for the warm welcome. Secretary Clinton, always great to see you. Distinguished guests, colleagues, and friends all. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today about an issue of great importance, a subject that isn't always easy to talk about, and a practice that has gone on for far too long, female genital mutilation. I'd like to start by underscoring the value of events like this, because the ability to discuss FGM openly and honestly is an essential step in stopping FGM effectively and completely. For that reason, we owe a significant debt of gratitude to those who have raised awareness of the practice and pushed for change, particularly the women and girls who have been subjected to FGM and for whom this issue is a uniquely personal one. I represent a district in New York City which encompasses parts of Queens and the Bronx. We like to say the Bronx. And I have met with girls who have felt pressured to travel overseas to be cut. By speaking with them, this issue has become personal for me because it affects people I now know. it affects my constituency. I have no doubt that your brave voices and their brave voices have played an instrumental role in the success we've had in combating FGM, including the U.S. Congress passing a law in 1996 with bipartisan support. How often does that happen? Making it a crime to commit FGM against a minor. And the United States is not alone in this ban. Without the courage of so many who shared their stories, I question whether this law would have passed. Those of us who oppose FGM must continue to raise our voices because much more remains to be done. The numbers are daunting. According to the World Health Organization, up to 2 million girls each year, or 6,000 per day, are threatened with FGM. Clearly, this is not the time for a go-slow approach. Rather, we must use all of the tools in our tool belt, everything from education and community-based outreach efforts, like the important ones carried out by the groups here today, to legal penalties to end the violence against women and girls. For this reason, I have introduced a bill entitled the Girls Protection Act of 2011, which would make it a crime to transport a minor out of the country for the purposes of FGM. And I too would like to thank my colleague, Congresswoman Mary Bono Mack, for co-sponsoring this bill with me and working so hard to get it passed. I also would like to acknowledge the efforts of my colleague, Charlie Dent, who is here today, as well as others who are supportive of this legislation. Thank you, Charlie, for being here today. It is time that we pass this bill into law so we put law enforcement on the side of women and girls. In addition, I hope that we can explore the creation of a United Nations General Assembly resolution calling on all countries to ban FGM in their domestic laws and support educational and community-based outreach efforts to prevent FGM, which would help to end the transport of minors abroad to skirt domestic laws designed to prevent the abuse. 2 weeks ago, I and nearly 20 members of Congress sent a letter to the State Department urging consideration of a General Assembly resolution. I hope the United States will lend its name to this effort and press for the creation and passage of such a resolution. By doing so, the global community will send a strong and unified message that FGM is harmful to women and girls and is simply unacceptable in the 21st century. In closing, I'd like to leave you with a quote from Martin Luther King Jr., who said, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about the things that matter." This issue matters, and we will not be silent. Lastly, I'd like to mention the work of two great organizations working to stop FGM in my hometown of New York City, Equality Now and Sanctuary for Families. They provided critical input on drafting the Girls Protection Act, and their efforts mean so much to so many women and girls in my district and throughout New York, throughout our country, and throughout the world today. But now I have a great honor to introduce a woman who needs no introduction, a leader on this and so many other important issues, but most importantly to me, my friend, Secretary Hillary Clinton.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I am so pleased to see all of you here. There are a number of familiar faces who have been working on this and other related issues for a number of years, and a lot of new and young faces, which is especially welcome. I think that the fact that you are gathered here with us to mark the first ever event at the State Department
concerning the International Day of Zero Tolerance to Female Genital Mutilation is a great step forward to raise visibility, to create a great movement that will support the brave women and men who understand the need for this practice to stop. And it's especially gratifying for me to be on this stage with Ambassador Milan Verveer, our first ever ambassador on behalf of our country, standing up for the rights of women and girls around the world. And Joe Crowley, who, as you might gather, is a good friend of mine, has been for many years. He and his wife and his family are very close to me and my family, and I'm very proud that he is here on behalf of his legislation. I think it is also very important that Representative Dent is here as well, and this is the kind of united front on behalf of an issue that we are extremely proud to see. When I think about what we are doing, I know it is not the work of this day or this year, but of a generation. But the good news is progress is being made, and through education, through outreach, through advocacy, we see that progress taking place. You will hear in just a few minutes from some of the real leaders in this movement who understand the issues, who have been working in the science, research, health fields, who have been working in the grassroots, in the villages, in the legislatures of countries. And it is, for me, a great honor to have all of our panelists with us. There are a number of people, as Milan just said, watching us through the miracle of technology far beyond the Ben Franklin Room, and they will have a chance to participate in the discussion later. I think that the importance of this event is really proven by the quality of the panelists, by the representatives of ambassadors and leaders in so many fields. I am especially pleased to see from UNICEF, Gita Rao Gupta, because UNICEF has a very big role to play in the work to end this very terrible practice that has gone on for too long. I've also, though, seen for myself how progress can be made. You'll hear in a minute from Molly Melching. Molly is a real hero of mine, a friend of mine. She will be talking about the excellent community-based work that the international organization Tostan that she began in Senegal is doing. I first got to see this work in 1997 when I was in Senegal. And Molly took me to a village where the village elders had really been thinking deeply about what the implications were of FGM on their daughters and their granddaughters. And they were reaching the conclusion by asking a lot of hard questions about what does this do to a girl's health? What does this do to her future ability to be a mother? What does this do to the quality of life of her family? And what they were learning was leading them to conclude that this practice really had to end, even though it had gone on for as long as anyone could remember. And what was so striking about my visit with Molly that day in that village was that Tostan and Molly were putting this very impressive discussion into the context of democracy. And there was a wonderful skit that was being performed about what democracy meant and who got to have a voice and what kinds of concerns should be brought to the village. I know Molly reported that one woman said, "What do we do with this democracy?" And what the women decided, with the support of the men in the village, was to change the custom of cutting their girls. So they organized their arguments, and they went to the male leaders, and they talked from personal experience about the pain of the procedure, about the lasting psychological damage it causes, about the health complications during childbirth, including the risk of death. They asked their local mullah to participate, and he then began to study and look to the Quran and to talk with others, concluding there was no religious basis for the practice in Islam. And eventually the village voted to outlaw it. Then they took to the road, and the male leaders went from village to village, starting a discussion about the harm from female cutting, talking to neighbors who, just like them, had accepted it because their parents, grandparents, great-grandparents had accepted it. And by the time I returned to Senegal a little over a year later, several villages had renounced the practice through this wonderful conversation that was started. It wasn't somebody coming from the outside, pointing fingers, saying how terrible they were. It was people from both outside and inside asking questions about, why do we do this? And is it something we should continue to do? And is there another way, perhaps, to think about giving our girls what they need, like education, to be good mothers when their time comes? Then they decided to petition Senegal's president to ask for national legislation outlawing FGM. I remember being so impressed by this grassroots democratic movement that had taken to the road and gotten all the way to the capital of Dakar. And I invited the very first villagers from that village I had visited to come to a meeting, to sit at the same table with powerful officials and representatives of NGOs. And I was so proud to introduce them because they really had walked the walk. They were living the hard work of human rights activism. All these years later, I am still very proud of the work that I saw and that is being done in so many places. Let's be clear. This is a deeply entrenched practice in many places. So we have to be both unrelenting in our efforts to end it and understanding about what works and what doesn't work. And I think you'll hear that firsthand from the panelists. We enter into this with a lot of humility because we have to empower those people in those villages to make the decisions. Now, we cannot excuse this as a cultural tradition. There are many cultural traditions that used to exist in many parts of the world that are no longer acceptable. We cannot excuse it as a private matter because it has very broad public implications. It has no medical benefits. It is, plain and simply, a human rights violation. And as we think about the rights of young girls to be free from both physical and mental violence, we can understand why this is such an important issue that deserves attention from the United States Congress and from leaders across the globe. I think that for me, the honest and direct conversation that we are having, especially hearing from those with firsthand experience, is what makes this different. Our partners from the UN will be at leading efforts to raise international awareness. We will be looking at laws and resolutions. We will be looking at what can be done in families and villages. We will be making the case this is not a women's problem. This is not a women's issue. This affects the human family, and therefore we all have a stake in it. When a mother dies in childbirth due to complications caused by FGM, everyone in the family suffers. When women are sick from infections or girls miss out on their educations, communities also suffer. And what we have seen in Senegal and elsewhere is that when men understand the trauma that FGC causes, they are among the most effective activists for ending it. So we're elevating this issue, but it's part of our overall elevation of the role of women and girls in our foreign policy, economically, strategically, politically. Every aspect of our policy is intending to highlight and promote the role of women. And we are funding community-based programs that involve women and men in public awareness campaigns about the dangers of FGC. We're working in refugee camps and other humanitarian settings. Through USAID, the United States co-founded the International Donors Working Group on Female Genital Mutilation / Cutting, which needs continued high-level international support, and we will redouble our efforts. I'm very proud today to announce we will join with the University of Nairobi to fund a Pan-African Center of Excellence in Kenya, which will advance African research and strategies to address FGC. This center will focus on developing local solutions to end the practice and offer medical training on how to support the women who have been hurt and damaged by it. I hope others in the business and international communities will join the United States in supporting this very important new initiative based in Africa, where we think it needs to be. Now, Kenya has just passed an outright national ban on FGC, becoming the 18th African country to do so. Last year, the African Union called on the UN General Assembly to adopt a resolution banning it, and we will certainly work in any way we can to support the African Union in that. There is more to be done. We need more advocacy, more interaction between policymakers and those in the field. We need to empower men and women, and especially girls, to speak up for themselves. We need to ultimately overcome the deeply rooted gender inequalities that either tacitly or actively permit and promote such practices. So this is a very important day here at the State Department, and I'm especially delighted that we can have people here speaking about this, as well as others throughout Africa by means of the internet, so that we can become stronger in numbers and understanding and effectiveness. It is my hope that we can certainly see the abolition of this practice even sooner than within a generation, but no later than within a generation. And that we also do everything we can to create conditions for every child, girl and boy, to have the chance to live up to his or her God-given potential. Thank you all very much.
And to thank Secretary Clinton and Congressman Crowley, who are going to return to the press of their duties. And we're going to take just 2 minutes to rearrange this stage so we can get all the panelists up here. So just bear with us, and we'll be back in a second. Okay, if I can ask our panelists to join me up here. Come this side. So we are truly very excited to have these long-time experienced people describe what is working at the local level and what more needs to be done. Let me quickly introduce them. Maybe you could just nod so we know who is who. Molly Melching is the founder and executive director of Tostan, the person that Secretary Clinton referred to. She is one of the preeminent leaders on community empowering approach to abandonment. Tostan has reached millions who have gone on to abandon FGC, now in some 8,000 villages. Zainab Ayega was born in Senegal. She is the executive director of Sautu Yetu Center for African Women and Families, a community-based social service organization. Imam Muhammad Majid, also originally from the executive director of the Al Dulles Area President of the Islamic Society of North America. And as an imam, he has brought religious leadership to the movement against cutting. And I just want to say that yesterday I had the experience to join by having trouble with this mic. We're breaking down here. Joined by Molly and the imam at the Foreign Press Center for a discussion with a group of journalists, and it was an animated discussion that went on for more than an hour. And you are in for a treat, just based on the two of them, and now they're joined by three more, and they have a lot to impart. Thomas von der Austin Sacken is the co-founder and director of Wadi, a German-Iraqi NGO. He has long experience working in the Middle East for human rights and democracy, and to combat violence against women. And Nafi Diop, also born in Senegal, is the coordinator of a joint UNFPA and UNICEF program on ending cutting. It is the world's largest program promoting abandonment. And she has extensive research experience in this area as well, specifically in the testing and evaluation of programs. So that's our panel, and now we'll get started, and at some point we will move to our audience for questions as well as to those who are gathered in our embassies in some of the African countries. So Molly, since you were mentioned in the Secretary's speech, let's start with you based on your experience over many, many years now. What do you think the most effective way is that we can use efforts at the grassroots level for working towards abandonment of FGM or FGC?
Thank you. I may have to use your microphone. Thank you so much, Milan. And thank you for all for being here today. What can be most effective? Is what I say over and over is education, 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 education. In Senegal, we started this program doing a basic education program for women and girls who had never been to school, for women and girls and men also who needed information, basic information about their bodies, about health, about their human rights. They needed this information in order to be able to make important decisions. And it is this education which led so many communities to decide it is time to abandon female genital cutting. But they went beyond just that, just deciding in their own classroom or their own community. They realized that in order to make this sustainable, because female genital cutting is a social norm, it is one that is so important for a young girl if she is to be married, if she's to be respected and be part of the community. You really have to change that social norm so those expectations are no longer there. that everyone knows that this is not a criteria for marriage any longer. And it was from the villagers themselves that Tostan realized that to end this practice, they had to reach out to their entire social network. And so you have the imam, and I thank the imam for being here today, because the religious leaders in Senegal were so critical to this movement being successful. The men, the village chiefs. Together, they went from village to village. They reached out to their relatives, their neighbors, as the Secretary of State said. And together, they came and decided as a collective group that they would end this together. This means that if I marry in another village and the girl that I want to marry is not cut now, she will be accepted, she will not be ostracized, she will not be marginalized, which girls would have been if this had not been a collective decision. It was Demba Jawara, a local imam, who gave us that strategy, and he was the first to walk from village to village. And since then, hundreds of women and men and religious leaders have literally walked or taken horses and carts and gone around to communities, getting their relatives on board to abandon across borders. And this movement has spread from Senegal, where there are 5,002 villages which have publicly declared their abandonment of this practice, to the Gambia, to Guinea, to Mauritania, and even to Somalia and Djibouti, where we have brought the program. And again, the important thing was, as Secretary of State said, it was not imposed from the outside. This was a 3-year program in national languages where people could learn their human rights, decide what they wanted for the future of their community, and then look at what the consequences of certain practices, not just female genital cutting, but also child marriage and domestic violence and so many other issues, so that together they made this decision for human rights, for health, a positive movement. And in a nutshell, this is what happened, with, of course, support from the many partners who are also here in the room today. UNICEF has been a partner for 20 years in this process. We cannot thank them enough. USAID in Guinea and Mali, and then other partners such as Sweden and Norway, who, and other foundations and individuals who believe in this and have seen that FGC can really end in one generation. It's very exciting.
You know, I think one of the powerful points that Molly has made is that this is a practice that is a deeply entrenched social norm, a moray, and those are the hardest to change because there are sanctions attached to changing it. If you don't go through this rite of passage, you will pay a price in the eyes of others in your community. And what has happened is that deeply entrenched practice has created the proof that culture doesn't have to be immutable. And it changes in a way when the whole community embraces that change, that the sanction now is, if you don't do it, you will harm your daughter. You will not be doing what is best for her. And I think that's a tremendous transformation that occurs because the whole community joins in this effort. And as you said, it can only happen if everyone is part of it. So, Imam, we know that this practice has often been justified, and I'm sure still is justified, in the name of religion, in this case, Islam. And it is why Molly said what she said about the imams who've been in the leadership and why you have given so much to this cause, to demonstrate that is not the case. So tell us a little bit about what a difference religious validators can make in this instance in bringing about this transformative change.
Thank you for inviting us for this very important discussion. I would like to say that the imams are the trusted leaders in their community to give religious guidance and the spiritual guidance. And therefore, having the imam to be on board in addressing this issue is very crucial. Because if somebody were to know that from the religious perspective, from the Islamic perspective, that this practice is not acceptable, if a person come to know that violating human rights and the rights of the woman to live a normal life is not acceptable, if the congregation will hear that from the imam in his Friday sermon, that will empower the women and men who stand against this practice. And that's why when Mali was talking about the imam, gave them the idea how to include the other members of the community to address the issue. It is crucial because the imam is the one who knows who are the players you can bring together, because he is the really not only the spiritual leader, but is a community leader. He knows who is who in the community. And therefore, I have heard myself, some people try to argue religiously this practice is acceptable in Islam, but Muslim scholars have written in this issue and have addressed this issue in many forums. And there's a publication by Dr. Salim Al-Awa, for example, of Egypt, and other Muslim scholars who are addressing this issue. Therefore, I think when I was hearing Mali yesterday, that was inspired, and the ambassador, I said we'd like to have an imam, you know, coalition to say imam against FGC. And it will be a movement across the Muslims world to have the imam to say, we will not accept this practice, we will support NGOs who are working in this field.
So I think we need to launch that coalition.
Yes, you got it.
Nafi, you have had enormous experience in this, both from a research capacity, your work at through UNFPA and UNICEF. What do you think is the best way to discuss it in terms of the larger public? Is it a human rights issue? Is it a public health issue? Is there some better way to describe it? How do we engage? We've talked about the community level, but how do we get more people to focus on why this matters?
Thank you so much. And just allow me to say that I'm very pleased to be here today and to be able to share a lot of progress that have been done in this campaign against female genital mutilation cutting. And I will start by just giving some few backgrounds, actually, for the community work. I think that this is very important, as you mentioned, the research aspect. And what we have learned over the years, that from that experience that TOSTAN was implementing in Senegal, and with the successful first public declaration in 1998, we're able with research to put some numbers behind what was happening, because we need somewhere to also convince an international communities and other actors, other NGOs, national governments, that this is a way to go. So that was a very important step in that process of providing an evidence-based research that this community-led strategy is working. What we are now also really doing, the UNFPA, United Nations Population Fund, and UNICEF joint program on female genital mutilation cutting, is really to make sure that this knowledge is widespread and disseminated everywhere, because Africa is large, and we heard from other, of course, panelists, that it is beyond Africa, Middle East, Colombia, Indonesia, Philippines, there is, and of course, migrant communities in Western European and European countries. So we need to build the capacity of others to do what TOSTAN is doing in Senegal. And this is what this joint program is doing since 4 years now, systematically disseminate this knowledge and building the capacity of other NGOs, particularly in 15 priority countries, including Egypt, Sudan, and other countries in Eastern Africa, Kenya, and all, to really understand how to go. Because education was there. A lot of NGOs were doing that education component, were doing education on health. they have started to understand that education on human rights, so just to come to your question, was also important to bring in the package, because we understood that education on health only was not sufficient, because unfortunately it led to the medicalization of the practice in countries like Egypt, where medical doctors started to do this practice under the pressure of the families, of course. So the health argument is not sufficient. This is why the human rights argument is very important also. And all this capacity building effort is ongoing. But then I will add something else, which is very important, which is the legislation and the policy and the ownership by the governments. And I'm very somewhere proud to say that, for example, in the plan of action of Senegal today is really a human rights plan of action. So they completely endorse that strategy and were able to put it in and have a national policy against it. And we have a lot of countries that are following that pattern. And this is very important today, because the government needs to be also on the front of this campaign. NGOs like Tostan, the different NGOs that we have here are doing tremendous work, and they are very pioneer and doing whatever they can with very small resources. But at one point, the government needs also to endorse that and be on the forefront and facilitate the work of the NGOs. So this is really what this UNFPA UNICEF joint program is doing: the community support and capacity building, but also support the government in all the legislation effort and the policy effort. And we heard the Secretary of State talking about the Kenya example, which is something that we really support during the last 2 years, Kenya government and parliamentarians to enact a legislation which is going really to support the whole process and support the community, community willingness to abandon the practice. And this is a public health issue. It's a human rights issue. It's really a violation of women's and girls' rights. And we are, as the UN agencies, really trying to make sure that the campaign will grow, have more visibility, will have the support of the member states, but also the support and be able to really facilitate the work of NGOs by supporting Tostan in 6 countries, for example, but also, as I said, building the capacity of other NGOs. Thank you.
You know, and you also reminded us so rightly that this isn't confined to Africa. And Thomas, you've done a lot of work in the Middle East, and Zainab here in the United States. So maybe you can both address the reality among the immigrant community in the United States, Zainab, for example, and how you got into this. And then Thomas, what the situation is in the Middle East and how that might present itself. Is it the same? What do we know? Is there sufficient data to make some conclusions?
Do you want to start, ladies?
I think the work among immigrants has to be different because the context is different and the process of migration is different. You have people who are resettled as refugees, you have people who come as visitors, you have professionals, and then you have people who come and overstay their welcome. So the context itself is different, and the issues the immigrant communities are facing are a little bit different. Let me just retrace a little bit and give everybody a background. In the 90s, there was actually a lot of work, both from government to the communities and vice versa, around this topic. And then the 2000s, nothing happened. And there was a lot of hope in the community. A lot of women and girls were actually interested in preventing the practice from occurring here, but they didn't have the support from the service sector, from public policy, from foundations, from government. So the desire and the energy that was mobilized across the country, we had actually almost like 16 states where if you went into any of the communities, whether it's Somali community, Sudanese community, you know, Burkinabe, you'd find groups who are actually saying, tell us how to do this work. tell us what we need to do. And then when we didn't actually follow through with what we said we were going to do, everything died down. So now we're starting again, and it's a little bit harder because now people don't trust what anyone says because you failed them once. But what we've known and we've experienced in New York and that has really worked is a couple of things. One, we've developed a holistic community engagement model, which engages men, engages women, engages parents with two objectives. One, what are the new social norms that are being created in these communities? Because we can't assume that because they've immigrated, they've brought the same social norms here. That might not necessarily be true, or it could be true. So what are the social norms that are being created? How do parents make decisions about marriage? What is the transnational connection between here and back home? And how is the information being shared? Second is creating safe spaces for people to get information, dialogue about what values and social norms do they want to continue and which ones do they want to let go. And then the third is access to service delivery, especially for women and girls. Where do they go for health care? Where do they go for counseling? You know, if they needed maybe trauma, maybe stress, or questions about this, who can they go to that can give them information that they can really trust? So these are the things that we're working on. And we actually, in New York, it's actually fathers who reached out to us to say, can you come and talk to my family? Because this is what they want me to send money back home to do. What can I say to them that will convince them not to use my money to go and have my sister's daughter cut? So we've been engaging on those discussions. And we then 3 years ago launched a national grassroots network because we realized that a lot of communities didn't have the experience and the resources that we had, but we could help with developing the capacity to engage the community on different levels. So across the country, we've been working, and we're trying to document it because we want to document process of change. We want to document the process of creating gender equality and gender dialogue within our communities. And then we want to be able to share that with policymakers, hopefully, and then they can support the work in the grassroots movement.
Thank you. Thomas?
Thank you so much for the invitation. Well, I'm actually working basically in Iraq, and when we bumped into the problem of female genital mutilation in the Kurdish areas of northern Iraq in 2004, no one really believed that. We heard this is an African problem. Since then, we were working and working, and thanks to a lot of very, very courageous women and men in northern Iraq, a first research was done, finding out that there are areas with 100% of mutilation, that the average mutilation in northern Iraq is 50%. And this became a campaign called the Stop FGM Kurdistan campaign, which was lobbying not only inside Iraq, but also outside for the understanding that FGM is not only an African problem. Through media, through collecting signatures, to the parliament. Last year, finally, the parliament of the autonomous region of Kurdistan passed a very progressive bill, domestic violence bill, and banned female genital mutilation 7 years after it first came to appearance. It was a complete taboo in 2004, and you don't find any information that there is FGM in Iraq before 2005. Now, we can proudly announce that thanks also to, with the support of the State Department, there are 6 FGM-free villages in Iraqi Kurdistan. It's not 6,000 like in Africa, but the first 6 villages declared themselves FGM-free. I have a small picture for you. For the first FGM, the sign that was put up just last July, by the members of a village, we are FGM-free. And in that village, ladies and gentlemen, we can announce that for the first time in the history of that village, 2 girls, 4 years old, will not be cut. And the village is proud about that. And on the 6th of February, we held a commemoration on the day against female genital mutilation in Sulaymaniyah, northern Iraq, and the mayor of that village was speaking, a very nice man who was very supportive in front of all the local media, and that gave a big sign for others, that he proudly announced that his village, in a joint decision of the women and men in that village, is now FGM-free. And I can tell you, in the name of these very nice villages, when we ask them, because we cooperate for village empowerment, not only for education, for village empowerment, we ask them, what is your first wish? And they said, we don't have a secondary school, and we want that our children are having a better life than us. So could you arrange for us transportation of our children in the next village so that they can join secondary school? And one comes to the other. Another organization heard that, and now they supplied them with a first secondary school. And just now, media is reporting about that. And they see stopping FGM doesn't only mean stopping FGM. It's a first step to have a better community life, to be an example for others. It's a new concept of honor. It's a new concept of honor. The second thing I just want to say here, if you would have asked anyone, including the UN, in 2002, does female genital mutilation exist in Iraq? They said, oh, no. So the Middle East is a black box. Together with people from Iraq and Egypt and Yemen, we just held the first conference about female genital mutilation in the Middle East in Beirut last month. Because we know, and there's testimony, that it does exist in other countries too. We have evidence from Iran, from Syria, from Saudi Arabia. It is known from Yemen. But still too many people consider this an African problem. And this doesn't help the brave people who are trying to combat that in these countries. So, in the name of all these people, I appeal to you, don't consider it an African problem anymore. Look also to the Middle East. Look to Southeastern Asia. And let us together do the approach to get data. There is no data from Yemen. There is no scientific research in Yemen. I appeal to the UN, please. You have the capacities. Help doing this research. We did the first research here in 2007 about the prevalence of FGM in Iraqi Kurdistan. That was without international help, with very, very limited funds. But I think it is very important that we reach out to the Middle East. And it's very important that you are sitting here, because in our questionnaires, 80% of the women say they do it because they think it's sunnat. And a lot of clerics do very strongly lobby this practice, very strongly. So we need the support from people like you inside your community, because there are few clerics who are very bravely opposed this, but they're the minority. There should be this discourse also in the Middle East. And I think that's the message. And the message, really, my colleagues and friends from Iraq were asking me to deliver here. Don't forget us. Don't forget us in the Middle East. Don't only think about Africa. We are also there. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. You can hear the passion of each and every one of these leaders on the stage for what they do and the results they have seen. And in fact, Thomas, I was in Egypt about, I don't know, maybe 2 years ago or a year and a half ago, where I went to a abandonment ceremony, a declaration ceremony to renounce FGC, and there were literally hundreds and hundreds of people from the local village and outlying villages who came together after a considerable effort to get to that place, and they were very proud of what they had achieved. So it is in other places as well. I think we ought to turn to maybe first to some of our participants in Africa, if we have any questions coming in.
Thank you, Ambassador Vivere. Our first question is from our embassy in Dakar, Senegal, and they've submitted the following. We know that FGM is performed by communities to preserve women's virginity for marriage. In yesterday's press call, Imam Majid mentioned marriage counseling as a possible facilitator of behavior change. Imam, how do you imagine marriage counseling as a tool for changing beliefs and behavior?
The premarital counseling is very crucial of educating the couple about their rights, about how to have a healthy relationship. I do marital counseling, premarital counseling before I officiate any marriage. And I have them to have 6 sessions, talk about communication, healthy relationship, talk about abuse, what kind of, all kind of form of abuse. And actually, I looked at the man in the eye, I said, listen, you understand what I'm talking about? about the issue of abuse. But I talked to both a couple about, how to build a relationship that have mutual respect, mutual understanding. I do believe that the educating people in the issue of marriage, whether in public school, in those countries, where the imam or the giving a sermon or giving a lecture in the mosque, it will change people's perceptions of relationship. And therefore, I do believe that it should not be, a woman taking her daughter aside says, I want to teach you how to be a good wife. And no one telling the man anything. And then sometime part of this teaching, how to be submissive, do whatever the man says to help to keep a healthy marriage. It has to be having the couple to sit together, the imam or a social worker explain to them their mutual rights and how to build a healthy relationship based on those values that I mentioned.
Do we have another question from Africa?
We have one more from our embassy in Bamako, Mali. And they've asked, are the terms we're using, specifically the word cutting, sufficient in reflecting the impact of this practice? Do these terms reflect the lifelong physical, emotional, and societal repercussions?
I think any number of you might want to take that one.
Change microphones. I would just like to say that if I say the word female genital cutting, it is because the villagers themselves told us at Tostan, our staff, our supervisors, our coordinators, please do not use the term mutilation because we do not do this practice to harm our daughters. Mutilation means cutting with the intention of harming, if you look in the dictionary. And I think we all agree that there is no woman in Iraq or in Senegal or in other African countries who want to harm their daughters. They're doing this because they have no choice, because it is a social norm. They do not want their daughters to not have husbands, to not be respected. Women in Senegal could not cook and serve food to families if they had not gone through this practice within the ethnic group. They could not serve water. They were rejected. They weren't part of the women's decision-making group of the community. And therefore, you wouldn't imagine doing this to your daughter. It had to, come from this collective decision first where everyone changed at the same time. But one of the major things that the people who are leading this, because it's not Tostan staff that is leading this movement, it is the people who are the participants, who made these decisions within the classroom, then within the community, then within the social network, and at the public declarations when they first started. And we, at the beginning, didn't understand how very important this was, as you said. And when they talked about it, they said, just please, do not judge us. And this word is very judgmental. And we see this in the newspapers. So could you please just help us by watching vocabulary? Don't talk about fighting a tradition. Talk about promoting health. Talk about promoting human rights. Get us in a positive movement for change. And rather forward-looking rather than backward and condemning and shaming and blaming, which all these words seem to do. I know other people don't feel this way, and we respect that you use those words, but I will never use those words because I work so closely with the villagers who have said, there are words that close doors to dialogue. There are other words that open doors to dialogue and allow us to discuss among ourselves without feeling like we are being judged from without. If you use those words, you will accelerate and facilitate the process. That's the only reason that I always say female genital cutting rather than that word mutilation.
Nafi?
Maybe what I can just add is that, of course, this is a very good rationale for using the term cutting instead of the term mutilation. It probably depends on the, where or who is the audience. And so I understand that there is a lot of activists and really pioneer groups and international NGOs, including the Inter-African Committee, who created that International Day on Zero Tolerance, who really insist on the term mutilation. For the United Nations Population Fund and UNICEF, we are using female genital mutilation cutting just to try to federate both view. But what I want to say is that whatever this is called, in local languages, there is different ways, thousands of ways of calling it. Whatever it is called, we are and we want to target the same issue. When you talk to some communities, of course, you use their language, including their local language, and you are respectful and you use a culturally sensitive wording. But when you talk to the international community, then you want also to put some emphasis on the harmful effect of this practice and the fact that we need to act and quickly. So whatever the name is, I think that the most important thing is let's move forward and let's put an end to that practice of FGMC.
Anybody else want to say anything? No? We'll go to our audience now, please.
My name is Lucy Mashour, and thank you, Thomas. I met you 3 years ago in Berlin, and you have gone a long way. Good job. And thank you, Ambassador, for meeting me almost a year and a half ago while I came to plead. I'm a survivor of female genital mutilation at the age of 9. And I call it mutilation because it's mutilation. Cutting, you are accidentally, you can cut yourself. I understand that mothers love their children, but there is no way I can decorate the truth because we have to show it and name it as it is. It's grave danger. This is sexual slavery in modern society. And I am telling you, on February 6th in Kenya, it aired. If you can go to our blog, Mashua Voice for the Voiceless, I blog. It aired a documentary showing that recent numbers, 3 million Kenyan girls are at risk every year, not only Africa alone. So I am pleading with the agencies, please do not underreport or underestimate the numbers. We, the survivors, we know we work closely day and night. I work 24/7 with refugees all over the United Nations, working with them on phone with the doctors every day, and Ambassador can tell you. And also we have foot soldiers that rescue girls every day in the whole of East Africa, and we give them safe havens, not particularly taking them to the rescue centers. We find them homes where parents adopt them and give them the safety of a home, because they get lonely also in the rescue centers, and they get to get back sent home to the same village where they will be mutilated. As we speak right now, this is a young one-year-old girl that the mother, who loves her daughter very much, thought that stomach infection will be cured by mutilating the genitals. Really, this is very, very, very grave
ill danger when we are talking about female genital mutilation. The word cutting, it's like we are decorating the truth. And this is high time. This has gone on for a long, long time. Women are bleeding to death every day. We have women living with complication. We go through reconstructive surgeries. You can go even through to reconstructive surgery. You never regain it back. It's permanent damage. So let us call it mutilation and let them face the fears and the truth. And it's high time that these laws are not going just to be decorations. We want them implemented and followed through. We are tired of lip services from the government. And we want us as a whole community, as we come all together, let us fall through this and let us make some arrests for it to serve as a lesson. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Amanaz.
Thank you so much, Milan, and we're really grateful to the Secretary for this extraordinary occasion, fighting FGM at the United States and international level, and thank the panelists. But I just wanted to point out that just as it is true that FGM is a human rights problem and not an African problem, at the same time, we have to be very careful to make sure that it's not seen as a Muslim problem or an Islamic problem. And for that, I think both in Molly mentioned the importance of education, and as we educate policymakers, legislatures to advocate against FGM, and as we mobilize the public to fight against FGM, it's very important to bring in the large majority of Muslims around the world who do not practice FGM, and to use that, you know, for an empowering, for solidarity building, for mutual education. The statistics are bad enough, but to make sure that it is seen as a human rights problem, and to, for the purposes of mutual learning, to point to the example of large numbers who do not, who have hardly ever even have awareness of the problem, and to establish these connections, not simply on textual basis, that it's not in the Quran, but in practice of the diversities of practice of Islam and the vast majority who do not practice FGM. Thank you.
Thanks, Manaz. Good point.
Thank you very much. My back is towards them. Is it fine if I continue? Maybe I just step here. I just want to say thank you very much also to, first of all, Honorable Melanie Verva, and to our panelists for a very comprehensive commentary on the issue of either FGM or FGC. My name is our Ambassador, Dr. Josephine Ojambo, from the Kenya Mission to the United Nations, and I also want to just thank those who made it possible for me to be here today. I'd like to, on behalf of the government of Kenya, pass a deep message of appreciation through you to the Secretary of State for her announcement of the upcoming center in Nairobi. We welcome the center wholeheartedly, and we do wish it all the very best of success, and we look to colleagues such as Sandra here in the audience for that success. I'd like to also echo a few words that have been said this morning and speak about the legal framework on FGC. And just to say that in Kenya, in the year 2010, women leaders from across Africa gathered and declared a decade called the African Women's Decade, which brings to the fore grassroots approaches to improving the status of African women, and in particular to addressing FGC. I'd like to also let you know our recently promulgated Constitution of 2010 gives not only equity to women, but also allows them to attain the highest standard of health. And that health also includes reproductive health and rights, and will address FGC. I say that because I've been challenged sitting here amongst you as audience from government to respond a little bit about our efforts. I'd like to also just share best practice from Kenya, and suffice to say that the issue of FGC is also a socio-economic issue. Those who cut do it as an enterprise. Our government is looking at putting micro-enterprise into the hands of women at grassroots level so that we can redirect their efforts from earning money from this practice into earning money around other activities. I also just like to say that in the communities where we have FGC in Kenya, which are not necessarily Muslim communities, it's done across the population of Kenya, that young girls are taken out of school and enter into early marriage as a result of the practice. Therefore, FGC is retarding their educational advancement and contributes, therefore, to dependency and, in the long term, to poverty. So we see it as a socio-economic issue beyond one of human rights and public health. I think that's important for us to underscore. I'd also, therefore, like to speak about current action and let you know that last year, indeed, the highest summit of the Africa Union got together and the leaders actually enforced or gave force to the Africa group at the United Nations to take up the matter. We have been discussing the matter of FGC at the UN. The Africa group has led the discussion on a biannual basis at the Commission on Status of Women. This year is our year when we present it as the Africa group for discussion, now beyond the Commission on Status of Women, but at the UN General Assembly. We will have a major advocacy event this year, supported by Italy and with the Africa group, to bring the issue of FGC to the General Assembly so that it receives support from member states at a global level. And this responds to some of the issues shared by Congressman Crowley. I'd like to just say, therefore, that FGC also exists in Italy because immigrant populations have crossed the Mediterranean and settled in Italy and continue the practices there. I therefore just want to end and invite all of you to continue with your efforts, and in particular, Melanie, look forward to working with you to increase greater ownership for eliminating FGC within the Africa group at the United Nations. We welcome Her Excellency or Madam Clinton at the time when indeed we will present it to the General Assembly and look forward to the success of your projects. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I've been getting the signs that we have to conclude, but before we do, we want to hear some concluding remarks from the Deputy Executive Director of UNICEF, Geeta Rao Gupta. She has a long history in working on women's issues, formerly the head of ICRW, and now in this very important position at UNICEF. So,
thank
Geeta,
you so
bring
much.
Bring us to a close.
Thank you very much, Milan. I certainly will. I want to thank the U.S. government for their leadership on this issue, especially Secretary Clinton. She is amazing. Her leadership on every issue for women's rights is right where it should be. And to Ambassador Vivere for her hard work. It's been almost 4 years, and I cannot believe that we never had this position before. I wonder what we did without it. Thank you very, very much for all of you being here. The success of this issue and the progress we have made on it, we have to first acknowledge and pat ourselves on the back because we have made progress. And it has been primarily because of the persistence and courage of individuals, such as the ones here on stage, as well as many of you in the audience, but also because of partnerships. And I think that's the theme that emerged in all of these presentations. You heard about the UNFPA, UNICEF joint program to accelerate the abandonment of FGMC that we, that UNICEF is very much a part of and grateful for. But its partnerships, UNICEF also partners with TOSTAN. So the UN with civil society organization, religious communities, and most importantly, partnership with families, with mothers, with leaders in communities. It's partnerships that has gotten us this far, despite the limited funding, despite the fact that this was an invisible issue. The fact that we've got this far is because of that. And I wanted to say to your comment, ma'am, that it needs everything. It needs the anger, the passion, but it also needs the understanding. It is a human rights violation, but it is rooted in a normative context. And that is the piece that UNICEF is working on. Other organizations should take the other angle on it. That's the way we make progress, is each one takes the issue from a particular vantage point and pushes forward where you have your strengths. It needs activism, it needs creativity, it needs data, it needs social interventions and economic ones. So it needs all of the above. And that's what we have learned at UNICEF. We have chosen to focus our efforts on the social normative basis of this practice, as many of the other practices against girls and women, whether, you know, in broader sort of violence against women. Because individual behavior, wagging a finger and telling somebody to stop, is not sufficient. You can give a person information, but if behavior, we have learned, is rooted in the rewards and sanctions that are you know, sort of imposed by society on individuals, and that is what keeps a practice like this, that is essentially harmful, but, you know, in sort of makes it exist across generations. Tostan taught us a model for social normative change, and for that we'll always be grateful. UNICEF with UNFPA, through this joint program, provided a mechanism to learn from that and apply those lessons across many different countries, to refine them, to disseminate them, to share them with others. So we are grateful for the partnership with Tostan. And the results are so encouraging, as you have heard. In many countries, we have accelerated the abandonment of this practice greatly. Burkina Faso, Gambia, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Senegal, Sudan. In others, we've just begun. But we are making, village by village, an effort to move forward. In 2012, I just wanted to share with you that UNFPA and UNICEF will conduct a joint evaluation to generate further evidence so that we can keep backing up our efforts with evidence. I won't talk much longer. I just want to emphasize the importance of combining the anger in the activism with a positive, non-judgmental, non-accusatory approach when you're dealing with communities where you're seeking to bring about the change. And just to end with the Marcel Proust quote that our executive director at UNICEF used, and I have begun to use now more actively because it really made an impact on me. The real voyage of discovery consists not in seeking new landscapes, but in having new eyes, seeing things from a different perspective. What didn't seem like a human rights violation to communities for many years is now seen as a human rights violation. If you see a behavior that seems very negative from the perspective of the person who's engaging in it, you might learn that that person is under pressure to engage in it, and then you might deal with the problem differently. So I leave you with that thought. What we need are new eyes. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Geeta. That was excellent. And let me just end with a little story, since she talked about new eyes. And that brings me back to this building and progress. And I can tell you that there are some officials still working here in the human rights section called DRL, Democracy, Rights, and Labor. And I remember one of them saying to me years ago that she had pleaded with her superiors to let them address this issue as a human rights violation, and was told, no, it wasn't a human rights violation. And then in 1995, the then First Lady of the United States, now Secretary, said in her speech, in that litany I mentioned, that this was a violation of human rights. And that same person went to her superiors and said, well, now that the First Lady of the United States said it's a violation of human rights, can we begin to work on it? So we've come a long way. So thank you all very much. Thank you, Imam. Thank you, Zainab. Thank you, Molly. Thank you, Nafi and Zainab. And thank you, Thomas. So thank you all, and thank all of you.